23 meters wide, 7.5 meters high. This design will be used for a huge stage curtain in the main hall of Japan's National Theater. The flowers of the four seasons, arranged rhythmically across a golden background. The curtain design recreates almost exactly a work of the Rimpa School of artists. The Rimpa School flourished during Japan's Edo period, which lasted from the 17th until the mid-19th century. Every year, this factory produces around 100 stage curtains, both large and small. Some are made for export, but nevertheless, almost all the designs are in the traditional Rimpa style. A famous pair of screen paintings by Ogata Korin, entitled Red and White Plum Trees. The name Rimpa comes from the last syllable of Korin's name, because his work typifies that style. The style emerged around the turn of the 17th century, pioneered by the artists Sotatsu and Koetsu. On the right, the young and vigorous red-flowered plum tree, its branches reaching upward. In the center, a flowing stream. Broad strokes and fine strokes in a rich and varied pattern. On the left, the plum tree with white blossoms. Its sturdy trunk and rugged branches burst beyond the border of the painting, then bend back to appear again. Bold ink shading and patina for the bark and moss. The details are painted with great accuracy, but the arrangement of space is stylized and abstract. The blending of these two different elements gave birth to the characteristic style of the Rimpa school. Towards the end of the 19th century, when Japan again opened its doors to the outside world, the lovely forms of the Rimpa style crossed the seas and arrived in Europe to have a major impact on the development of European trends in art. One of Japan's leading art and literature critics, Shuichi Kato, has come to Paris to trace the story of that meeting between East and West. In 1879, an international exhibition was held in Paris. That was just 10 years after Japan's Meiji Restoration, which marked the start of its modernization. Trying hard to build ties with the Western nations, Japan sponsored a pavilion which featured many samples of pottery and other traditional crafts. And that gave a new boost to the influence of Japanese art in the trend called Japonisme in France and the rest of Europe. Compared with the European concept of art for art's sake, Japanese pictures and crafts brought a fresh sense of art closely related to daily life. One example of Japanese influence was the impact of the ukiyo-e woodblock prints on European painters, especially the Impressionists. But along with Japanese prints, the decorative art of the Rimpa school arrived in Europe around the same time, and it gradually attracted many admirers. Then came the Paris Exposition of 1889, for which the Eiffel Tower was built. The growing influence of Japanese art was clearly evident in the exhibition hall. At first glance, this might seem to be a work of the Rimpa School from Japan. But in fact, this creation of glass was made in France. It represents the style that emerged in the last decades of the 19th century, known as Art Nouveau. These lines recall the natural growth of plants. A skillful use of flowers and other natural objects, the decorative style of the Rimpa School inspired new forms in Europe. At the Paris Exposition of 1889, the Frenchman Emile Galle displayed some 300 pieces of glassware, pottery, and other household items, and won many top prizes. This Galle vase features a dreamlike design of mayflies. His bold departure from symmetry seems to have been learned from a study of Japanese craftwork. While visiting many museums in Europe, Shuichi Kato soon focused on the influence of the Rimpa style on Art Nouveau.
When we look at the works of Art Nouveau, of course, we notice themes of flowers, butterflies, and small birds, as in Japanese art. Then we also come across dragonflies and flowers associated with Japan, like the chrysanthemum and wisteria. You see, the Art Nouveau artists often chose themes that seemed exotic to them, themes that they'd seen in art from Japan. Now, in the overall forms of Art Nouveau, they don't use very hard lines or straight lines either. They use soft lines with an emphasis on curves. Especially in Art Nouveau glass, like the pieces here in this museum at Nancy, many of the colors are soft, shaded, a little misty. So in many respects, in that sort of aesthetic sensibility, the Art Nouveau of Europe reminds me of Japanese art. Another feature common to both Art Nouveau and Japanese art is the use of stylized writing as a form of decoration. For example, here's a perfume bottle by Emile Galle, decorated with a poem by Pierre Dupont. Calligraphy, even whole poems, was used in Art Nouveau to decorate vases and other works as part of their overall design. The combination of words and pictures could be found sometimes in European art before, but the decorative use of lettering on glassware and furniture can be called a special feature of Art Nouveau. And more than any other Japanese art, that feature strongly reminds me of the arts and crafts of the Rimpa School.
Case for an inkstone used to prepare the ink for calligraphy. This was designed by Hon-ami Koetsu. The bold swell of its lid was a startling innovation in those times. And the inlaid pattern of writing is an important part of its whole design. tea ceremony bowl, also by Koetsu, in red lacquerware, known as the Snowy Mountain Peak. Without impairing its functionality, the artist freely displayed his decorative skills. A set of lacquered shelves, also probably designed by Koetsu. The artists of the Rimpa School sought to revive the elegant beauty of the imperial court during Japan's Heian period, from the 9th through to the 12th century. The lacquered decorations on these shelves all recall the literary masterpiece of those days, The Tale of Genji. For example, these pine seedlings on the top shelf are like those mentioned in the chapter entitled Hatsune, or the first song of the year. These moonflowers scattered over a fan recall the tragic heroine of the chapter entitled Yugao. See how the delicate tendrils of vine trail beyond the edge of the fan. And this ox cart with driver is like those used by the nobility in The Tale of Genji. Towards the close of the 16th century, peace and unity came to Japan again, after long years of warfare among the feudal lords. The townspeople, making their living through trade and crafts, emerged with new prosperity and power. A great part of the capital, Kyoto, had been destroyed in the long years of war, but the merchants and artisans rebuilt the city and revived the traditional Gion festival. This screen painting shows such town dwellers, full of energy as the growth of trade spread prosperity throughout Japan. Warlord Toyotomi Hideyoshi did much to promote national unity, peace, and trade. In 1588, he ordered the minting of these large gold coins. Gold seems a symbol of those days. Gold in coins and lacquerware, ornaments, and screen paintings. And those days also saw the coming of missionaries and traders from the other side of the world. The start of contact with Spain and Portugal stimulated both coastal and overland trade throughout Japan, and that in turn boosted the growth of cities. The Rimpa School of Art emerged from the new culture of the townspeople amid their growing prosperity. One of Japan's national treasures, a pair of gold leaf screens painted by Tawaraya Sotatsu, portraying the wind and thunder gods. The god of wind holding storms in his sack. And the god of thunder with his drums. Thunder god painted in white. And the wind god in green. drums leap beyond the frame of the painting, adding to its dynamic power. This work is considered a forerunner of the Rimpa School because of its striking arrangement of space. In the color contrast and spacing of these figures on their gold background, Sotatsu showed a stroke of genius. Boldly stylized portrayal of elephants, painted on a cedar door at the Yogen-in Temple in Kyoto. These might almost have been painted yesterday, not some 350 years ago. Another national treasure, again perhaps the work of Sotatsu. Sotatsu filled the entire surface of this sliding door with a single pine tree. Thus he achieved a new concept through a combination of painting and decorative function. The artist Hon-ami Koetsu showed his genius in many fields, and he was quick to recognize the genius of his contemporary, Sotatsu. The two artists, Koetsu and Sotatsu, even blended their talents in joint works. In this scroll, Sotatsu painted a free composition of the flowers and grasses of the four seasons. Then, matching the rhythms of that design, Koetsu added poems in his flowing calligraphy. The poems came from the classic 10th century anthology called the Kōkenshū. Up, then down. The rhythmic lines of the painting and calligraphy blend in a way that became known as a special feature of the Rimpa School. These hand scrolls from the early 12th century illustrate scenes from the Tale of Genji. They were painted about a century after Lady Murasaki completed that great novel. And they show some of the fundamental characteristics of Japanese art. The eyes and noses are drawn very simply. the overall composition is boldly stylized. The artist has chosen to leave out the roofs of these rooms so we can look down into them. The picture is divided by both diagonal and vertical lines. The distribution of space and color call to mind modern abstract paintings. But looking closer, we see that some details are portrayed very accurately, like the fingers of this flute player. And this woman's fingers can be seen through the gauze of her sleeve. Abstract composition and naturalistic detail. The tradition of combining those two elements was inherited by the Rimpa School of Art to become one of its main features. Another gold screen painting by Sotatsu, showing an ancient form of dance known as bugaku. Rather than emphasize the individuality of the masked dancers, he used their figures as design elements in his bold composition. Another screen on the same theme, painted by a later artist. The later artist probably copied the dancing figures from the same source that Sotatsu had used. We can see clearly how Sotatsu used open spaces for greater impact. Then, around the turn of the 18th century, the artist Ogata Korin emerged. Korin carried the aims of Sotatsu to an even higher level. Irises here, some perhaps painted with stencils, are repeated as uniform elements in a bold design.
The important point, the crucial factor in art like this, is the position of each object in relation to the others. I mean, it's the way things are arranged, one after another, as design elements across the picture. I think this approach has a deep significance. Not one of the objects in the picture is the central point. Rather, the emphasis is on their relationship. I might call that approach a way of dividing up abstract space, or, a way of differentiating space, of making the picture spaces themselves unique, special. The main point of the picture is the composition of its spaces. Of course, we can see this approach emerge long before the Rimpa school. For example, we see it in Chinese ink painting. Here's a famous painting by the Chinese artist Muki from around the 13th century. It's one of a number of his preserved at the Zen temple Daitokuji in Kyoto. You see, it shows a row of persimmons. Because it's an ink painting, there's some difference in the shading of each fruit. But the really important thing is their position, the amount of distance between one and the next. The picture is composed by spacing a row of nearly identical objects. And this same approach can also be seen in artworks by Korin. I think Korin's screen painting of bamboo can be called one of his most typical works. It shows just a line of bamboo stalks side by side. The main point is their spacing, the distance between one bamboo stalk and the next. The arrangement creates a spatial rhythm, and in an abstract sense, the subtle arrangement of space can have a special appeal to the viewers. Rather than the individual portrayal of beautiful objects, such arrangement of space has been the main task of Japanese artists. Of course, this trend is very clear in architecture, but I believe we can also see it in two-dimensional art, as in the paintings of the Rimpa School.
The art of Japan's Rimpa School crossed the seas to Europe and led to the birth of Art Nouveau. Let's take a closer look at how that happened. This art gallery in Paris formed a major stage for the meeting of Art Nouveau and the Rimpa School. It was opened in 1895 by the art dealer Samuel Bing, and its name came to be used for a whole artistic movement. Twenty years before he opened this shop, Samuel Bing had visited Japan, where he obtained many works of art, including a book of designs by Korin. His fascination with Japanese art continued to grow. For 3 years, starting in 1898, he published this monthly series, with editions in three languages, French, English, and German. These publications played a major role in setting off the Japanese art boom in Europe. One article, written by a leading art critic, Louis Gons, gives high praise to Korin. Begins, Korin, I love this name, its curve, its rhythm. It says his pictures are composed of indefinable curves. And it also says that Korin is in the front rank of masters, for his supremely rich decorative instinct and genius. The great French anthropologist, Claude Lévi Strauss, is a collector of Japanese art, like his father before him. He especially admires the art of the Rimpa School.
Il me semble que d'abord cette école est liée le nom d'un de vos plus considérables artistes qui a été Korin, l'un des plus révolutionnaires, et que c'est une école qui a su tirer le plus d'enseignements de ce retour, d'une part aux sources populaires et d'autre part à l'exploitation à des fins esthétiques de la matière brute, de toutes les matières sous leur forme les plus diverses. Et c'est donc Une école qui, par son imagination qui a été étonnante, et en même temps sa rudesse volontaire, a établi le lien, a rétabli l'unité entre les sources populaires de l'art japonais et ses expressions aristocratiques.
The city of Nancy in northeastern France, home to such industries as steel, textiles, and glassware. This city produced that genius at glassmaking, Emile Galle, and became a center for Art Nouveau. The garden of the Art Museum at Nancy displays the doors from the studio of Emile Galle. On them is carved his motto, "My roots are in the depth of the forests." Dreamlike vision of the sea. Works like this show why Galle is known as one of the masters of Art Nouveau. Delicate shapes of these leaves and branches. It's said that the works of Emile Galle cannot be reproduced today. Glass that might be mistaken at first glance for ceramic work. Galle named this vase the Vase of Sadness. Each leaf shows a separate design. Beauty, not only in glass, but also in furniture. Again, in his versatility, Emile Galle reminds us of artists of the Rimpa School. The Art Nouveau movement flashed through the art world, then was gone. But its heritage remains at this London store, which has a history of over a century.
That's very nice.
store features printed cloth based on traditional designs for Japanese kimono.
It's inspired by your old Japanese prints. It's very fine, tiny prints.
Textile designs tend to appear and disappear very quickly, but these patterns have retained their popularity decade after decade. The year 1900 saw another international exposition in Paris. Just 11 years had passed since the exposition of 1889, but the sentiment of the times had changed. Rather than culture and art, the emphasis was on industry and national power. Nations competed in showing the development of their industrial technology, rather than the beauty of their handicrafts. The Art Nouveau movement, influenced by the Rimpa School, swept through Europe around the turn of the 20th century and left its mark in many fields. Thanks to the advance in printing technology, many splendid posters were produced in the Art Nouveau style. Such posters found their way to Japan during the 1910s and 20s and had a big impact. The artist Sugiura Hisui pioneered the field of poster art in Japan, influenced by Art Nouveau. And that trend also influenced the artist Takehisa Yumeji, known for his wistful portraits of women. He too created many striking posters.
We can see the characteristics of Rinpa-style painting in the Genji screen by Sotatsu, or the famous screens entitled Red and White Plum Trees by Korin. Their main feature is the use of strong, relatively simple flat masses as a major element of the picture composition. This screen painting by Sotatsu shows a scene from the tale of Genji. In the background, we see flat green masses representing mountains, in contrast to the detailed portrayal of the ox cart in the foreground. Those flat green masses play a very important role in the composition of the whole picture. That same approach can be seen in modern art. In fact, it's one of the most common techniques in modern designs and posters. Look at the use of simple masses of color in this poster by a contemporary Japanese artist, Tanaka Ikko. Now, in conclusion, I'd like to say one more thing about the Rimpa School of Art. It simplified and stylized the forms of nature in quite an elegant way. We can see this very well in the treatment of water in those famous screen paintings by Korin, entitled Red and White Plum Trees. Look at how the form of flowing water is simplified and stylized. The color can be called stylized too, but that abstraction of shape really grasps the essence, the basic nature of flowing water. After that, when other Japanese artists considered water, hardly any of them could escape from this pattern. And that influence has lasted for some 300 years. I think the fact that Korin's way of portraying water could have so much influence for so long shows what a decisive, essential approach it was. That's a kind of strength. We can sometimes see that same phenomenon in the case of certain religious themes, which are conventionally portrayed in certain ways over a long period. But Korin managed to grasp the essence of something we can see any day, that is flowing water, and his form of stylization managed to survive for some three centuries. That was certainly no easy feat in a culture as complex as Japan's. And because he could create that sort of thing, in a sense, Korin and the Rimpa style are still with us today.
This stage carton, weighing as much as 1 ton, recreates the Rimpa style. After a month of work, it's finally ready to hang. The Rimpa style formed one major basis of Japan's decorative art. It blended pure painting with decoration in a fresh, new form. And the refined beauty of the Rimpa school designs can still capture our hearts today.